Thank you very much, youth choir. If you have your Bibles, I'd love for you to turn, but also to tune in your ears. We're going to be listening to 1 Corinthians chapter 1 in verses 18 through 25. Let's hear the word together.
For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God.
For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since, in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe.
For Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men.
Today we get the privilege of looking at a verse or verses that we heard this past week and hearing the word in 1 Corinthians. And we're going to target as we begin in verse 18. It says, the word of the cross. And I think sometimes we just talk about the cross, but the way that Paul phrases this in the letter to the church of Corinth, he expresses it as the word of the cross, which means it needs to be spoken, it needs to be shared, it needs to be articulated. But before we get there, and as you see that we're going to be gathered around the table in just a moment, I want us to go back a little bit. I think sometimes we, especially as believers, 2,000 years removed, that sometimes as we read through the word of the cross, as we're going to talk about, oh, the blood that was shed for me, and we hear the words, but I think sometimes we sit in pews that actually have cushions. Sorry about the no cushions in the back there. And sometimes we have aircon, and it feels like we're very comfortable. And I think when we use the word cross, and then we try to connect that with discomfort, it's a cognitive kind of a concept, but it's not exactly touching our heart. So before we go any further, to just get us into the atmosphere, into the context of the word of the cross, I want us to tap our five senses today. And I want us to put ourselves where Jesus was 2,000 years ago on the cross. And I want us to just to ask this question, what were those senses experiencing while Jesus was hanging on the cross from 9 in the morning to 3 in the afternoon? So if you could just, and some of you may be sharper in certain senses and some of you may be sharper in other senses, but I just want us to not just go right into the conceptual part of what God is trying to teach us, but my prayer is that you would engage with the word of the cross today. First one, what's he, when you touch, that's one of the senses, what's he feeling in his physical body right now? As you reflect, as you remember what happened that day, the very first thing that they did is they thrust a crown of thorns on his head. So he was feeling those thorns and those briars that were penetrating to the skull. Those thorns were probably this long, 2 or 3 inches long as they were jammed upon his head. So that's what he's physically feeling during this crucifixion. He's feeling the nails and the spikes going into his hands and to his feet. So as far as touch and feel, he feels that type of pain and that type of agony and that type of what I would say is discomfort. So what's he tasting at this time? And obviously when you're dying, all kinds of tastes go through your mouth. But in addition to that, if you remember at the very last, there was a sponge that was filled with a sour wine that was jammed into his mouth. It enabled him to speak the last 4 statements, but that's what he was tasting. What was he smelling? What senses were going through his smell? Many of you have been around hospitals or people who are about to die. You can actually smell death. You can actually, there's rooms, and I can't describe it, but I know that smell when I smell it. And there had to be the smell of death as well. What did he hear? What were the divine acoustics tuning in on that day of the cross? And obviously there was a plethora of noises and sounds. that were kind of coming into his system. Now, obviously, there were the crowds and the mobs saying certain things. There were religious leaders jeering him and mocking him and ridiculing him. There were the throw of the dice with the Roman soldiers gambling for his clothes. What did he hear? Maybe did he hear his mom sob as she was standing at the foot of the cross? Just the sounds, the acoustics, the lightning, the thunder. What did he see, the last sense? Well, he's obviously saw the people with hate and mockery and contempt. But he also saw John the Beloved. He saw his mother. What did he see? Did he see the tears? Did he see the love? Did he see the compassion? Did he see the pain? He saw the Roman soldiers gambling for his clothes at the foot of the cross. He saw the thief on each side as they're hurling abuse at him. But he saw them. And he saw the crowds. I mean, but my thing is, what did he not hear and what did he not see? And if you remember when he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? I think he was hearing the crowds. He was hearing the criminals. He was hearing the religious leaders. But he did not hear the voice of his father at this time. I think sometimes we just kind of zoom right through that. Because I want to introduce to you the discomfort of the cross today. Because I think 20 centuries later, we've kind of put cushions around it. We've decorated it. We put jewelry on it. And sometimes I think we forget that this was this discomfort. And this discomfort of the cross is what we're going to be talking about this morning. In fact, that discomfort on the cross will actually bring us eternal comfort if we embrace the discomfort of the cross. But if you reject the cross and choose the comfort of the world, you're going to actually embrace what I would say eternal discomfort. So let's see what the Word of God says. We come to verse 18, and if you know the history or the theme of 1 Corinthians, actually verse 18 is the theme verse, is what we would call the thesis of this entire epistle. And so let's read this again. It says in verse 18, "For the word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." So I want you to see a very clear thing from the very outset of this epistle, that the crucified Christ moves us to a decision of discomfort. The fact that you arrive today at IBC and you're hearing the cross today immediately puts you in a place of discomfort. No matter which way you go, there are going to be two directions you can go, but no matter which way you go, you will experience discomfort. This cross immediately confronts you. It challenges you, and you're going to have to move to this discomfort or you're going to have to move to this discomfort, but you cannot stay the same. You see, the cross is everything that the gospel is built upon. It's the foundation. Everything gravitates toward that. Everything points to that. And yet, the church at Corinth has done something with the cross. If you read through the pages of this letter, you can see that their attitude is changing. They're almost saying this, that the cross is too basic, Paul. It's too simple. Let me put it in Singaporean terms. Pastor, this is P1. This is P2. We're way beyond that. We're in O levels. We're in uni right now. We're working on our PhD. Why do you keep bringing up the simple thing of the cross? We've grown beyond that. That was the first century expression in relationship to the cross. The 21st century version of Christianity has also responded to the cross, maybe not identically like that, but this is how the 21st century is responding to the cross. It's not politically correct. It's ugly. It's violent. It's vile. In fact, this is what has been disturbing to me over the last week. One of my dear, precious family members related this. She said, "You're not going to believe what happened at our church." She's a part of evangelical church, and for signage, and there as they go into this, and it's a big church. It's the signage as you go in. They've always had a sign that had the sign of the cross, and that's when you drive up into the car park. That's the sign. This is the church. Welcome to this church, and big cross there. Welcome. But this past week they've changed it, and the pastor actually explained why. But let me tell you what they took down the cross image, and on all the letterhead, this is new image. And so instead of the cross, they said, "We're going to replace the cross because the cross draws lines. We're going to replace it with a circle because the circle is more inclusive." And so their new signage is actually a big red circle. It's a beautiful red circle. And they, in that circle, they put like lines this way and this way. It looks like a roof. And then right in the middle, the bottom part of the circle, they put a looks like a door that's white. And so what they're saying is this. The cross draws lines, draws distinctions, draws differences. But we don't want to do that. We instead want to be inclusive. So how do they define inclusive? It says the lines of the cross draws distinctions, but the circle will include. And so their circle has omitted the cross. And they say we want to include people by omitting what God has drawn. You see in this passage in verse 18, it says the word of the cross. What does a cross look like, right? You can't get any more lines than that. And I would dare challenge this. If God draws the lines, I dare any human being to erase the line that he drew. In fact, the line, is, what does the line say? It does draw distinctions, does it not? It draws a line from heaven to earth. It draws a line from the throne of God to the sinful heart. And the line this way draws a line that says all are equal and it stretches across all of humanity. It grows across every line, every distinction, every ethnicity, every language. And it says this, that this is the line that God has drawn. So what is the line? It says in verse 18, the word of the cross is what to those who are perishing? What does your word say? It's foolishness. So you have two choices. To some, and I would say the choice there is to reject the crucified Christ. And if you reject the crucified Christ, you will embrace foolishness. This is what the word of God says. That if you reject the crucified Christ, it says you are embracing foolishness. What does foolishness mean? Well, in the original language, we get our word moron. Any of you ever heard of that word? Don't say you use it daily, okay? This is not a good sign. Moron. We know what that word means. It means a foolishness. It fool. It means nonsense. It doesn't calculate. It doesn't figure out. That it doesn't make sense. Moronic. And this is what they're calling, because they said God has shunned. I mean, they've shunned the cross. They've shunned God, and they've labeled it as foolishness, as moronic. They look at a powerful God, and he appears powerless on the cross. How could that make sense? So as they shun the cross and they deem it to be foolishness, what they've done, though, is as they embrace foolishness, as they go against and repel the gift of the crucified Christ, God says now they're in the process of perishing. It's an active word. It's a very beautiful, it's a very picturesque word. When it says that you're perishing, it means not that you ultimately perish the moment you reject Christ, but the moment you reject this crucified Christ, you begin the directional shift, the process, the journey of going toward destruction, going toward ruined, and going toward being actually perishing. So God's word is very clear. You have a choice. So the choice is this. You reject the crucified Christ. You embrace the foolishness of the world. If you reject the discomfort of the cross because it's not politically correct or it's ugly or it's violent or it's vile or it's unbecoming, and you want to choose the comfort of this world, you actually will ultimately choose eternal discomfort. These are perishing. So what's the flip side? If you reject the crucified Christ, you embrace foolishness. But if you receive the crucified Christ, it leads to the power of God. What a radical difference, right? What a striking contrast that God has given you two choices. So if you receive Christ, God's word says if you receive the crucified Christ, you'll actually experience the power of God. What does the power of God look like? The world offers a lot of versions of power, do they not? I mean, there's some powerful governments, most kind of east and north of here, all right? There's powerful governments in the world. And so we think of power in those terms. We think of power in terms of military. Certain military, what kind of nuclear capacity do they have? And so you think of troop numbers. You think of all the technical advances. So you think of military might. You think of businesses and economic power. There's certain global companies that can make a decision that could actually send ripple effects through the entire economy across the globe. So we think of power, even in money itself. If you have a lot of money, if you have billions and billions of dollars, this is kind of power that you have. Sometimes we think power is like status. Like, what's that title? And that gives me power. That gives me authority. Sometimes it's education. It gives you that clout. It gives you those credentials. Sometimes it's position. But none of these that the world offered in the version of power will be able to save your dying soul from hell. No matter how rich you are, you go through the same crematorium here in Singapore. Your ashes look no different than anybody else's ashes. Now, I hear there are certain countries that there are certain niches that cost a lot of money. And just for a niche like this, I believe the latest studies have shown, niche just like this, in Hong Kong, $50,000. Now, let me tell you, dust to dust. There's no distinction. But yet we think if we have the world, we have the power, but there's no power other than the power of the crucified Christ that will be able to transform your heart. The Bishop of Notre Dame was given a speech and a talk, a sermon in the cathedral, in that Gothic cathedral, and he was sharing a story of an event that had taken place years before of three boys coming into the church in the cathedral, and they were very rowdy and boisterous and rebellious and defiant and even blasphemous. And two of them dared the third. So they said, "We dare you. Go into the confessional and make up this wild, crazy, bogus confession. And let's try to shock the priest." Now, I have had people try to shock me, okay? So it's already been done here, but this is his story. So the guy takes up the dare. He takes it up and he goes in there and he just lays out this bogus confession that's supposed to shock and rattle the priest, get him out of his collar and everything. And now some of you did not grow up Catholic, so you may not recognize these terms, but the priest, for his forgiveness, he had to do a certain penance. That's an action to kind of make it right. And so his penance was this, and this is what the priest told him to do. You have to go to the center of the cathedral, look at the crucifix, and say this phrase three times. All right? So this is the phrase that the priest told him he had to do. "For all of this," so you're supposed to stare at the crucifix and say, "For all of this, you died for me, and I don't give a," and then he gives an expletive. Aren't you glad I didn't say the word? Okay? And so he went out, and they started laughing. He told his friends what the priest said. But the two guys said, no. In order to complete the dare, you actually have to do it. So he said, okay. So he goes to the center of the aisle. He looks at the crucifix. And he looks straight at the crucifix. And he says, "For all of this, you died for me. And I don't." And he just couldn't continue. It's like his voice choked up. He went silent. It was almost choking him. And he kind of shook that off. And then he says, he begins again, he makes the second attempt, and he says, "For all of this," as he's staring at the crucifix, "For all of this, you've died for me, and I don't," and he couldn't finish. And this is how the Archbishop of Notre Dame finished the story. "I was that young man. As I stared at the crucifix of Christ, I could not say that. I'm telling you, there is power in the cross. There's something that the world does not understand. It melts the hardness of your heart. It overcomes any human obstacle, any human gap. There's no sin that my God cannot cover with a cross. There's no place that you are so far out of reach that he cannot reach. This power of the cross is the power to transform this broken heart and make it whole. This power of the cross can transform your home and your marriage. The love of God flows most freely through the cross." So to those who are being saved, those who are being rescued, those who are being delivered, those who receive the cross, the crucified one, God's word says you are in the process of being saved, of being delivered, and you have the power of God. Now we come to the second part of the message in verses 19 through 21. So we see the first part, the crucified Christ moves you to a decision of discomfort. So you're going to have to move. Either you choose the discomfort of the cross and ultimately the eternal comfort of heaven, or you choose the comfort of this world the AC, the cushioned chairs, all of those things, and everything else the world promises, and you choose that, but ultimately you experience the discomfort, the eternal discomfort of hell. Your choice. Everyone's going to have to move toward discomfort. It's just whether it's going to be here or there. So we come to the second part. Now the crucified Christ exposes the foolishness of the world's wisdom. And it's very, to me, it paints a beautiful, a powerful picture. Paul, in verse 19, he almost invites the contenders to the stage. And he's going to open up the stage for people to interact with the crucified Christ. So let's pick up in verses 19 and 21. I mean, 19 and 20. The Word of God says, "For it is written," and I always love that. If you're ever in doubt with the world's wisdom, always say, "For it is written," and then cite the Word. Because this is where the Word challenges and conquers the world's wisdom. Look what he says, "For it is written," and he quotes Isaiah 29:14. He says, "I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the cleverness of the clever I will set aside." Then he goes through a series of questions, and he says this, "Where is the wise man? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world?" Now, to me, there's so many different reactions from the world of how they address God and the existence of God. So let's go through a quick quiz. When you have this mindset of atheists, what do they say about God? That there is what? No God. So that's one view. That's how you deal with God, right? And wait, how many of you, that clears a lot of problems, doesn't it? Like sin and consequences and punishment and hell and all of that. If you can just dismiss no God. So that's one view of how you deal with the crucified Christ. No God. Now there's a group called agnostics. Agnostics say that there is no knowledge of God. So we have no knowledge. So that's another way to kind of deal with this crucified Christ. Because again, it makes you uncomfortable, does it not? So you have to go no God or no knowledge of God. Then there's a whole nother group across humanity called polytheistic people who say that there are many gods. Yahweh just happens to be one of many. So they water him down. So some say no God, some say no knowledge of God, some say many gods, and your Christian God's only one of many. Then there's human secularism that says what? We are God. We are the final say. We are the ultimate. So whether you claim as humans to be God, whether you say there is no God or no knowledge of God, or God is the Christian God is one of many, all of those are responding to the simple crucified Christ. So Paul is inviting. So he opens up the stage, and guess who comes? He says, first of all, where is the wise man? So the first element. And the wise man is a reference to the Greek, the philosophers, the learned, the people who are skilled in rhetoric or oratory skills. They have much in the area of classical knowledge in literature. But it's not just in the intellectual realm, this wise man, these philosophers. It also had social status. Is that true in Singapore? That if you have a certain level of intellect or knowledge, that you also, that has benefits in the area of the social world as well. And this is the impact. Where is the wise man? The second target is, where is the scribe? So the first one dealt with and addressed the philosophers, primarily from the Greek mindset. Who would this target? Where are the scribes? Which group? The Jews. They're the ones who are scholars and articulate and well-versed in Old Testament and the Jewish writings and the Talmud, all of those elements that are with rabbinical sayings. He says, I invite you to the stage. Where is the scribe? The third group is, where is the debater? We would call this is the critic. This is an analyst. This is an analyst. This is a person who offers editorials. Are there a lot of editorials in our 21st century news? It's like, that's all there is. Like, they don't report news anymore. They just report their feelings or their opinions about the news. And so you have these debaters, the critics, all of these who offer their analysis. And yet God's word says, where are they? Now, it's interesting how he phrases this. Paul has a rabbinical background, so he's been trained in how to teach and how to convey information. And they were very famous by using, instead of just like a didactic monologue, they actually use the art of the question. And so when you hear rabbis, and you see Jesus do this all the time, he asks questions. But there's an interesting element about this question. He says, first of all, where is the wise man? But there's no pause. Like there's no gap to wait for an answer. Then he says, where is the scribe? And again, there's no pause. It just goes right to the next one. Where is the debater of this age? Do you know why there's no gap? Because there's no answer. The debater hasn't shown up. The critic hasn't shown up. The one who offers his analysis is nowhere to be seen. In fact, where is the scribe? Where is the Jewish scholar? Where is the one that's so well-versed? Where is the one that has the oratory skills and has the classical literatures down, and they can offer up an answer or a debate to this crucified Christ? There's no, and that's the key word, is where. Let me put it in our terms. If you're so smart, how'd you miss this? How many of you have ever met smart people who were dumb? Do not point at anybody right now. How many of you have ever met a smart person that was dumb? Am I the only one? So there are smart people out there, right? And they have amazing capacity, but they do stupid things. How many of you have brilliant, brilliant teenagers that aren't always acting so smart? See, we have those, right? And so God's word is very, very clear. He says, there's no answer. In fact, it's strange on the stage. There is an obvious omission and a stunning silence to the crucified Christ, because how are you going to respond to this? This doesn't make sense. And so God's word now comes in as he invites and he opens up the stage to the philosophers, to the scholars, to the scribes, to the debaters, to the critics, and he says nothing there. But then he moves and he says, Christ clears the stage. He says, this crucified Christ has made foolish the world's wisdom. And look in verse 19. Let's go back a little bit. He says, for it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise. The cleverness of the clever, I will set aside. So what is God's response? He clears the stage. Those people who thought they were so smart, thought they were so clever or keen or wise, nowhere to be found. God has destroyed them. He has set them aside. They're no longer there. He's, as verse 20 closes up, he's made the wisdom of the world foolish. Let's look at verse 21. For since the wisdom of the world through its wisdom did not come to know God, God was well pleased through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. So now the world doesn't understand, but this is where God takes delight. You can almost see him smiling as the world is confounded by the foolishness of the cross. But he says, if you learn this secret, you'll have the salvation of your soul. So this is amazing. Again, there's no comparison with anybody else. There's no competition. Christ and Christ alone stands by himself. There's no hope for your soul, no hope for your sin, no hope for eternity, no hope for peace, not a prayer for anything else. He's cleared the stage and he stands alone. And so now he comes to the final section of this passage where the crucified Christ confuses the world. In verse 22, he's going to mention what I would say two mindsets in the first century. You have a Greek mindset and you have a Jewish mindset. And so he's going to address both of these. Look in verse 22 as the world will make demands, and there will be two sets of demands. First one in verse 22, for indeed Jews ask for what? What does your scripture say? What are the Jews asking for? Signs. Then he says the Greeks are searching for what? Wisdom. So how many of you, this is credible request, you would think. Let's start with the Jews first. So the Jews are asking for signs. They're asking for proof. They're asking for evidence, something tangible, touchable, seeable, verifiable, to confirm the veracity of Jesus' audacious claims. And yet, there it is. We're asking for signs. And yet, let me back up a little bit. How many of you have ever asked for a sign? You could be honest today, okay? How many of you have ever asked for a sign? Okay, only 12 of you. Oh. How many of you have ever asked, like, give me a sign, God, should I marry this? Fill in the blank, right? So we always ask for a sign. Should I move here? Should I take this job? Give me a signal. If it rains today in Singapore, I need to go to church. Well, that would be a good sign, wouldn't it? 240 days you would be here in church, right? So, we ask for signs. But let me kind of back up. There's a biblical example that many of our people have used at IBC through the years. They said, Pastor, I'm praying for this, and I'm going to put out my fleece. Which character is that? Gideon. Remember Gideon? Okay, Gideon says, but we forget. We think, well, that's our, we want faith, so we need a sign, we want to believe. But let me remind you that when you ask for a sign, listen to this clearly, when you ask for a sign, it's actually an indicator that you do not believe. Where do we get that? Several years ago, we did the Year of Relentless Faith, right? How many of you remember the memory verses? Oh, IBC, my heart is sad today. Okay, Hebrews 11:1. Help me out here. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen. So if you want faith, it means you don't have to see. If you're asking for a sign, you're demanding to see, which is opposite of faith. So please don't tell me. You'll get a response that you probably would not like. Pastor, I'm going to be like Gideon. I'm going to put out the fleece. And I'm going to have to rebuke you for your unbelief. But God's word says when we ask for signs, it's not a sign of belief. It's a sign of unbelief. Let me give you two examples. In the Gospels, Jewish leaders, he said Jews asked for signs. Jewish leaders two times asked for a sign from Jesus. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 38, the Jews ask him, Jesus, give us a sign. And now remember, this is Matthew 12. Matthew 8, 9, all these, the chapters right before was miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle. Sign, 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 sign. But now in chapter 12, they said, show us a sign. Basically on demand. Well, this is what Jesus said. I'll give you a sign. The sign is of Jonah. What? We were thinking maybe you could stop the sun. You know, we could think you could strike the Roman emperor down. You know, he says, no, I'll give you a sign. It's Jonah. And what's the story of Jonah? He was swallowed by a fish for how many days? 3 days. And then what happened? A resurrection, right? A vomiting under the shore. And that's the sign that Jesus gave them when they demanded a sign. What was that a reference to? His death, his crucifixion, his burial, in his resurrection. You ask for a sign, I'll give you a sign. Jonah, 3 days in the belly of a fish. It represents Jesus' death, his burial, and his resurrection. In John chapter 2, at the end of the chapter, Jesus clears out the temple, completely clears it of all the money changers, cleanses the temple, we call it. And after that cleansing, this is what the Jews had the audacity to ask, show us a sign. Can you believe it? Show us a sign. So guess what he says? I'll give you a sign. This temple is going to be destroyed, and in 3 days it will rise again. What is that a reference to? His death, his burial, and his resurrection. Even in Jesus' ministry, they were asking for his signs, and he gave that. And what was the sign? The sign was the cross, was his death. If people are looking for a sign from God, look to the crucified one. Look to the Christ who hung upon a tree. In fact, the Gospel of John, is, as you've been hearing a couple weeks ago, John is divided in the first section is chapters 1 through 11. And that first section deals with the life and ministry of Jesus. But they give seven signs in John 1 through, begin with the changing of the water into wine at the wedding in Cana. But it culminates and it kind of leads to a crescendo where it leads with the Lazarus resurrection. And so Lazarus is raised from the dead, which lays the groundwork and the preface for the resurrection of Jesus Christ himself. And in chapter 11, verse 45, very profound response. It says, as a result of this, many of them believed. So they saw a sign and they believed. That was the purpose of the sign. But, verse 46, many of them went to go tell the Jews what happened. We call them tattletellers. People are telling on Jesus to get him in trouble. And so they saw the same sign, but two totally different responses. Would you agree? Again, let me ask you this. How many signs have you seen? How many signs do you need? God is calling us for faith. And he's saying the Jews are asking for signs. They're demanding signs. And he says, I've given you a sign. The sign is the cross, crucified. Jesus, God-man, became flesh in order that he would offer himself as a sacrifice. A line was drawn from the throne room of heaven into the heart of humanity. That line has been drawn. It's been stretched out to everyone who's willing to come, to those who are called, to those who receive. Ask for a sign. The second group, it says in verse 22, it says, that this sign, that the Greeks, they searched for wisdom. Now, these were students. They were seekers. They were students of learning. They thought that knowledge would give them peace, would give them satisfaction, would give them purpose, would give them glory, would give them power, would give them whatever eternal life they had in front of them. And yet God's word says knowledge does what in 1 Corinthians? Puffs up, makes arrogant. But that's what they were seeking. God says they were seeking that knowledge and that wisdom. But what does God's word say about wisdom? Where does it begin in Proverbs 11, Proverbs chapter 1 and verse 7? It says the beginning of wisdom is what? The fear of God. They're seeking wisdom, but they're doing it apart from God. According to God's word, you cannot get wisdom apart from the fear of God. You cannot have the wisdom of God apart from the crucified Christ. And so this is their asking, demands. So two sets of demands, signs and wisdom. So I love verse 23. It's actually God's response or God's answer to their questions. Look what he says in verse 23. It's simple. It's short, it's concise, but let's see what kind of impact it has upon your heart. Remember, the Jews are asking for signs, the Greeks are searching for wisdom. In verse 23, but we preach, and what's the next two words in your version? We preach what? Obviously, what's it say? We preach what? Christ crucified. That's the answer. Now you're going, that doesn't make sense. Let me remind you, this is God's plan, not yours. This is the way God has laid it out from the foundations of the world. You said, Pastor, that doesn't make sense. There has to be another way. And God's answer to wisdom, God's answer to signs, God's answer to the Greeks, to the Jews, and to our hearts is this. My plan is this, Christ crucified. Well, let's see what kind of response the Jews and the Greeks had when the answer was provided by our Lord and by our Father. It says, Christ crucified to the Jews in verse 23. What's the next phrase? To the Jews, it was what? A stumbling block. Now, we go to the original text. If we sounded out the words, it would be this, scandalon. We get our word scandal, which means trouble, disturbance. You know, it doesn't make sense. It's chaotic. And yet, to the Jews, you look at the crucified Christ, and it is a stumbling block. I can't get over it. I can't get around it. I can't get through it. I can't get past this. What was such an affront to the Jews about the crucified Christ? I didn't put it in your notes, but I want you to put this reference. Deuteronomy chapter 21 and verse 23. And so the Jews, I'm going to explain to you, according to Paul, why did the Jews see Jesus Christ crucified as a stumbling block? They were the ones that were anticipating the Messiah. They're the ones that were well-versed in the writings and the scriptures and the prophets and the law. So in Deuteronomy 21, 23, it says this, cursed is the man who hangs upon a tree. That came from the Torah. That came from the Pentateuch. That came from the law of Moses. It's biblical proof that Jesus Christ crucified is cursed by God. Thus, he can no longer be the Messiah. No way. Now, Paul gives us a little bit more insight. In this upcoming week, you're going to be listening to Galatians. And so Galatians will tell you this, that yes, cursed is man who hangs upon the tree, but Christ became my curse. Yes, he was cursed. The biblical proof in Deuteronomy 21, 23 is accurate. It's targeted. It's applicable to Jesus Christ. But the Jews forgot one key ingredient. That wasn't the curse that Jesus bore for himself. That was your curse and my curse. He was taking my condemnation. He was taking my judgment. He was taking my pain. He was taking my punishment. He was taking the hell that was deserving of me. And he became my curse on the cross. But to the Jews, they couldn't calculate this. And so they count it as a stumbling block. They couldn't get over that. Well, the Greeks, on the other hand, it says, we preach Christ crucified to the Jews, a stumbling block. To the Greeks, it's foolishness. That word again, right? It's moronic. It's no sense. Let me give you some ideas where the Greeks are thinking where it doesn't calculate. And maybe even in your mind, it doesn't calculate. How can you have a suffering God? Those words don't even go together. Suffering God. How about this? A criminal Messiah. How about somebody who cannot even conquer his enemies and they're hung up on a tree? a Roman cross as a thief, as a criminal. How can that make sense, right? But see, for us, and I'm trying to convey this to you as clearly as possible, the world just doesn't understand. When we're hanging on to the cross and we're preaching Christ crucified and we're preaching the simplicity and the profound message of God's love, that line that has been drawn, when we're trying to make circles faster, let's include everybody and omit the cross. No way. God drew the lines. The line has been made to your heart. And there's only one line back up to God, and it's the cross. And he targets your heart. This cross is foolishness to the world, though. It doesn't make sense. There are two missionaries. One's name was Stan Dell, and the other one's name was Phil Masters. And they traveled to a remote area in the mountainous regions of Irian Jaya in Indonesia. And they were targeting a tribal group there by the name of the Yali tribe. Now, you have to know a little bit about the Yali tribe. The Yali tribe says in its doctrinal belief, you would say, that anybody who has a question or even doubts or causes any division in their religion is immediately put to death. Zero tolerance for any even question. Not just a division of going another belief system, but even if you question the belief, you're put to death. Well, these missionaries had a passion for the Yali tribe. They felt a burden, so they went and they preached. And as they arrived there, they began to preach. And so Stan was the first one to stand up and preach. And yet it created and it caused a violent reaction from the Yali tribesmen. In fact, it was so violent, they took out their arrows and began to shoot the missionary. The arrows began to land inside of the missionary, and he would pull them out and keep preaching. Then his friend came, and he began to step up, and he began to preach, and the tribesmen turned their anger and their hatred toward him, and they began to shoot him. But they would not die. They did not fall. They just kept pulling the arrows and kept preaching. And it made the tribesmen upset and angry, but frightened as well. In fact, they got to the point they were begging them to die. Begging them. And ultimately, it took 60 arrows to kill Stan. It took almost that many to kill Phil. Yeah, they died preaching Christ crucified, right? The world didn't understand it. They responded to it in hate and hostility and violence. But because of their sacrificial death and because of the courage they showed and because of the message of God's love, that entire tribe came to Christ. The foolishness of the cross, it doesn't make sense to the world. But this is God's plan. This is his answer when the Greeks are searching for wisdom and the Jews are looking for signs. What's the answer? Christ crucified. Christ buried. Christ raised on the third day. So let's see verse 24. For those who receive this crucified Christ, two elements that you receive when you get it in the package comes included. You get crucified Christ, you get two things in that package. First one is found in verse 24, but to those who are called, to those who have heard the call and responded to the call, both Jews and Greeks, no lines of distinction here. This is what you receive. What are they? The what of God and the what of God. What does it say? The first one is what? The power of God. Now, wasn't that exactly what the Jews were asking for? Give me a sign. I want it now. They were asking for the power of God. They said yes. And this is God's response. Crucified Christ. But you have to go through the crucified Christ to get the power. They were trying to get the power without going through the crucifixion. How many of you are like that? God, I want your miracles. I want your healing. I want double the salary. I want my kid to get in this school. I want this level. I want this status. I want this title. Oh, the power of God. I want to be able to have the ability to do this and this and this. And yet God says, how do you get the power of God? Through the crucified Christ. You have to go through the cross. There's no shortcut. Second element, you get not only the power of God, what else the second one you get in the end of verse 24? The wisdom of God. The Greeks were searching for wisdom, for answers, for clues, and for some understanding. And they were doing everything else, but whenever they got to the cross, it was moronic. It was foolish. It was rubbish. And yet God says, if you go through the cross, you'll get the wisdom of God. How many of you ever want the wisdom and the power of God? Does that seem appealing at all to anybody here? Any of you want those two? Wisdom of God, power? No, I want to be dumb and weak. I think all of us want the wisdom and the power of God. But we contract our own ideas how to get there. God says you get the wisdom, you get the power of God through Christ crucified. And then the word of God says in verse 25, I love this. I think he could have closed it, this section in verse 24, but he kind of adds a little stinger to it. He says, because the foolishness of God is what? Wiser than the wisdom of the world, right? Let me tell you this. God outsmarted humans. That doesn't take long. That doesn't take much, though, does it? But even the foolishness of God, however low that you can get, we got the wisdom of God, but even the foolishness of God is wiser than whatever humans can put up. And not only that, the weakness of God is stronger than the power of men. God is calling you today. Today, he says, there's no way you can escape the domain and the dominion of sin over you apart from the cross. There's no way that you can have clarity and wisdom and direction for your family as you navigate through life without the wisdom of God. And you can't get the wisdom of God apart from Christ crucified. This is God's answer. This is God's answer to humans' question. Now, whether you receive it or reject it, again, the cross draws lines. Either you embrace it or you expel it. Either you receive it or you reject it. But you have to make a decision today because this cross will make you uncomfortable. But now we come to this table, right? Now I know in other religions and other expressions, it's very complicated how you approach God. There's certain steps you have to take. You have to know this. You have to do this. But yet, you look at the table here, and this is how Christianity is expressed. You have two elements. You have bread and a cup. A little piece of bread and a little cup. And some of you say, it's not even wine, Pastor. It's grape juice. No, it's wine in the making, right? But it's there. You're thinking, what? You're just thinking, hey, it doesn't even satisfy. If you're hungry today, this is not going to help you. This will make it worse. This is just a little piece of bread. Some of you say, can we supersize it? Can we add to it? No, but this is not the point. What does that little piece of bread represent, IBC? The what? The body of Christ, right? What does the cup represent? Now, all of a sudden, these little tiny things change, right? They're symbolic, powerful symbols, though. Because I think sometimes the simplicity confounds the wise of the world. But you take that little bread and you take that little cup, and all of a sudden they represent the body of Christ and the blood of Christ. But it also represents God's sacrifice for my sin and for yours. So now this table all of a sudden has, ready for this, heaven and hell hanging in the balance. If you receive this Christ crucified, heaven. If you reject this Christ crucified, hell. There's no in between. The lines have been drawn. Whether or not humans or churches want to erase those lines, they cannot. This is the truth of God's word. As you take this bread, as you take this cup, it represents the body, the blood of Christ. It represents the sacrifice. It represents the blood that was shed. It represents the sacrifice of God. It means that heaven and hell are hanging in the balance with whether you receive this crucified Christ or you reject this crucified Christ. But I think we don't want to make it that simple. We think that we're more advanced. We think that we're beyond that, Pastor. And I'm going, this is who we are. This is it. This is where we have to go. This is how we walk with God. We start at the base, and the base is this. I'm a sinner. The base is this. I need a sacrifice. I need the blood. The Word of God says there's no forgiveness apart from the shedding of blood, that God has to have the blood shed, and it's either my blood or his blood. And he has counted that sacrifice, and he's covered me with his blood, as we sang just a moment ago. And so as we invite you to the table today, and we're going to pass out the elements, I'm going to pray that you'll hold those elements for a while until we're all able to share them together. And then as we take this cup and take this bread, my prayer is this, is that you would receive the crucified Christ today. This is the simplicity, the purity, the power, the wisdom of God through the one who died for you. Because this crucified Christ is what I would call the negation, the final negation of every one of us trying to attain God on our own. This completely stops that effort because there is no way, no how we can ever please God apart from Christ and what he's done for us. We cannot, obviously, forget the simple message of the cross. Let's prepare our hearts now. Father, we come to you. around this table with the simple and the profound message of Jesus Christ crucified. Father, the world's looking for all kinds of things, signs, proofs, evidence. They're looking for wisdom. They're looking for knowledge. They're looking for intellect. They're looking for higher learning. They're looking for achievement. And yet, Father, you tell us that we find the wisdom and the knowledge of God. We find the power of God in the Christ crucified. Father, let our hearts return to that cross. Let our hearts embrace the love and the sacrifice that you so freely express to our hearts. Father, touch our hearts this morning. Father, yes, we embrace your discomfort in order that we'll receive eternal comfort. Father, as we embrace the cross and everything that is attached to the cross, Father, let us be bold in our faith. Father, I pray that today, the simple message of Christ crucified will usher in the power and the wisdom of God into our hearts. Father, prepare our hearts now for this table. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to ask that our men come forward now. As we reflect and as we remember, before we take the elements, as we're reminded of the great love that God has shown us in the simple message of the crucified Christ, I want us all just to quote John 3:16 together. Many of you remember this verse. And so let's say this together. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That was the message that God gave his disciples. And as he broke the bread the night before the crucifixion, which represents his body, he was hours away of placing that body upon the cross. And the Romans were going to nail him there. But that body represented a God-man. And he took this bread and he passed it to his disciples. And he said, take and eat, for this is my body, which is given for you. Then he took the cup, knowing full well that hours away that his own blood would be streaming down that cross, his innocent, blameless blood. In fact, the Word of God says it much better than I could ever say it. In Hebrews 9:22, it says, without the shedding of blood, there could be no remission of sins. And so he knew that. And taking that cup, he passed it to his disciples, and he said this, take and drink, for this is the blood of the covenant for the forgiveness of your sins. Today, as we walk away from this table, my prayer is that God has touched your heart with the simple and the profound message of the cross, that you would walk out with him in hand, in heart, of the wisdom of God and the power of God, but it can only come through the crucified Christ. And as we walk out of here today, my prayer is that hearing the word would just continue to cleanse, as Paul says in Ephesians 5, having been cleansed with the washing of the water of the Word, and allow the Word of God to flow through you. I'm going to have my brother Alex come and pray for us, but just as a word of notice, we've been selecting a text from our hearing for that previous week. Next week, we're going to do a text that I've actually never preached on in my 35 years of preaching, 38 years of preaching, and it is on Hebrews chapter 6, Can You Lose Your Salvation? And that's the verse that says that if you apostatize or if you turn away, if you walk away from God, it's impossible to renew them to repentance. So we're going to deal with some very difficult passages while we have a chance. So let me encourage you, as you hear the Word of God, allow the Word of God to become a part of you as we're walking through some text that maybe prompts questions and doubts and you want to know more. My prayer is that as we feed on the Word, God will give us clarity and understanding and power. Alex, would you come and lead us in a time of prayer, please?